I'ma crush it. Call me.
Hi, I'm Anthony Walker, back from Chachi Plays, a 24-hour fundraising event where I was able to raise $3,800 for kids' art programs at Toonzeum and Father Ryan Art Center. I'm happy to be back as your regular host of Unsung, our region's nonprofit online news magazine show. We have another special edition today as we feature Neil Alexander in the launch of LiveLikeLou.org. First, let's check in with the latest news from our area nonprofits. In celebration of its 10th anniversary, the Sprout Fund will commission a large-scale work of downtown public art at 429 4th Avenue across from the City-County building. Following a national call for highly qualified artists with a strong connection to the region, four artist teams were selected to create site-specific design proposals for the project. In March, a selection committee will choose one of these four designs. The work will be installed in late spring, early summer 2012. You can vote for your favorite at sproutfund.org/public art. Carnegie Science Center announced that it will host Guitar, the instrument that rocked the world, this touring exhibition of the National Guitar Museum from June 16th through September 30th. This fully immersive exhibition explores all facets of the world's most popular instrument, from its history as an instrument of popular culture over the past 400 years to the science of creating sound with wood and steel. Visitors will experience the science, sound, and cultural impact of the guitar in an exhibition that contains more than 60 instruments, ranging from the rare and antique to the wildly popular and innovative, along with hands-on interactives, models, touchscreens, performance video, audio, stunning images, and photographs. And just for fun, there's the world's largest playable guitar as certified by the Guinness World Records at more than 40 feet long. It's also fun for kids to climb on. Admission to all parts of the exhibit is free with general admission to the Carnegie Science Center. On a sunny Pittsburgh afternoon in June last year, Neil Alexander received the kind of news we all dread. The progressive muscle twitching he has experienced for the previous 18 months was diagnosed as amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, the devastating and incurable condition better known as Lou Gehrig's disease. Neil launched LiveLikeLou.org on February 15th to raise awareness for ALS.
Amazing human beings who are taking an impossible situation and making it all about the possible. And so with that, I simply want to hand over the mic to Neil.
Thank you, Grant. As Grant said, my name is Neil Alexander. I was diagnosed with ALS in June of this past year. I actually like to call it Lou Gehrig's disease, and I'm going to tell you why in a minute. Before I do that, let me tell you a little bit about ALS. It's a degenerative motor neuron disease. Motor neurons are kind of the fuse boxes that transport messages from your brain through your spinal cord out to your muscles. With ALS patients, those messages are impeded because the motor neurons, they oxidize or rust up. And when those messages are impeded, your muscles begin to twitch uncontrollably. And that's a sign that the muscles are in distress, and then eventually they atrophy, as you can see in my left hand, and then they eventually die. ALS patients eventually lose the ability to use their hands, their arms, their legs. They eventually wind up in a wheelchair, and then they have trouble swallowing, eating, and then breathing. And that's how most ALS patients die. They suffocate to death. All of this happens with little to no cognitive impairment. That's why they call it the glass coffin. So not only is there no cure for ALS, there's no effective treatment whatsoever. And most ALS patients die within 3 to 5 years. When Suzanne and I received the diagnosis this past June, we reacted in a way that I'm sure most people could understand. We reeled for a few days, we cried a lot, we still do. But eventually, a few days later, we realized that we had to do something to change how we were reacting to this. So I'm going to tell you in a moment why we like to call it Lou Gehrig's disease. Before I do that, let me tell you a little bit about Suzanne and I. I think it's going to give you some context on how we're dealing with this. Suzanne and I met 23 years ago. We're going to be married 20 years in March, just in a month. We are what I affectionately call control freaks. There is nothing historically that we have not been able to control, plot, chart, graph. In fact, we moved to Pittsburgh We met in Los Angeles. I served 5 years on the LAPD. I survived the South Central Patrol, the riots, the earthquakes, the floods, the locusts. We decided to relocate. We did a 2-year search on the best place to live in the United States, best place to raise a family, and we picked the city of Pittsburgh. The reason why I tell you that is there is literally nothing that you can do about ALS. And for people like Suzanne and I, that was a pretty tough pill to swallow. So we decided that we needed to figure out, because there's nothing we can do about my health situation, we needed to do something on how we were treating this diagnosis, how we were going to react to it. So I said I like to call it Lou Gehrig's disease. After I was diagnosed, I did a fair amount of research on Lou. I'm a baseball fanatic, a history buff, a big Pirate fan. Looked into Lou, read a few books, watched Pride of the Yankees, and I came to the conclusion that how we perceive Lou and our collective conscience is accurate. He truly was modest, hardworking, courageous, and had shown a fair amount of grace in the face of a pretty big, pretty tough situation when he was diagnosed with ALS. In fact, I like to say that when I was diagnosed, I felt like I had been inducted into a club. Somebody was saying to me somewhere, hey, we know this is pretty tough, but this is how you're expected to act. And you're expected to act like this because this is the standard that Lou Gehrig set. And rather than being a burden for me, it was a source of strength. And if you know anything about Lou's story, he didn't do it alone. He had a wonderful wife by the name of Eleanor. And I think that Suzanne has found this to be a source of strength as well. So after we kind of got our heads around this diagnosis, we came to the conclusion that this could truly be worse. We have an amazing group of family and friends. I work for an amazing company that has treated me remarkably well under these conditions, Heffron Tillotson. We are very thankful to be working at Heffron Tillotson. But we came to the conclusion that there are people out there that probably aren't as fortunate as we are. So for ourselves, for our marriage, for our kids, but more importantly for those people out there with ALS, we felt like we had to take our time and talents to do something to see if we can't affect some positive change. So we called the Pittsburgh Foundation and they reacted in a remarkable way. We set up a donor advised fund called livelikelou.org. I actually like to call it a foundation. We have three goals of our foundation. One is to raise awareness of ALS. The second is to raise funds for patient care in Western Pennsylvania. And the last is to raise funds to direct towards research that is targeted at finding a cure. We are actually up and running. We have our website, livelikelou.org, that you see behind me. As far as the things that we've done so far, I've been doing a fair amount of public speaking, like we are today, to raise awareness, to tell people what it's like to be diagnosed with ALS. And at times I get concerned about coming off trite. We truly have, I've had an amazing life, and I hope it goes on for quite some time, and I really wish I didn't have ALS, but I have never been hungry. There are people in our community that have been hungry. I have never been in fear, lived in fear. There are people who live in fear of their governments, of their spouses, of their parents. I've never lived in fear. And I've never been lonely. There are people in all of our workplaces who probably suffer from painful loneliness. I met the woman of my dreams. I have two amazing kids. I accomplished my childhood goal of becoming a police officer. I wish it would go on and on, but I'm at this point not gonna start complaining. And we hope to create a legacy for our children that we didn't just roll up in a corner when we got this diagnosis. I was talking to a good friend recently, and I said that, I believe everything I'm saying 95% of the time. And 5% of the time, I don't believe any of it. And I say, this really stinks. I can't believe it's happening. I'm being totally ripped off. My wife's being ripped off, and my children are being ripped off. But I used to fight those moments, and now I accept those moments, and I let them happen. And then when they're over, I get back to work.
The 17th annual Empty Bowls Dinner will be held Sunday, March 11th, 2012, at the Rodeth Shalom Congregation in Oakland from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. Empty Bowls is a simple meal of soup and bread that reminds us that many of our neighbors are struggling to feed their families. You can get all the details at the address below. The third annual Get Involved Pittsburgh Service Summit will be held at Carlow University on Wednesday, April 4th from 4 to 9 p.m. The Service Summit will feature 10 terrific breakout sessions featuring some of the region's most creative and innovative community leaders and speakers. More information is available at the link at the bottom. The PSVP 2012 Social Innovation Fast Pitch is Thursday, March 1st, 2012 from 5:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. at the Fairmont Hotel. You can vote for the best nonprofit pitch as they go for $35,000 in funding. Register at psvp.org. Thanks for watching Unsung. Be sure to share it with your friends. You can check out our previous episodes and our Unsung Uncut series over at pittsburghonvideo.org. I'm your host, Anthony Walker, reminding you to keep it awesome, Pittsburgh. We'll see you next time.
So I said, I'ma crush it. Call me the golden boy, cause it shine whenever I touch it. Don't rush it, the flow comes naturally. Actually, the whole hood after me. Masterpiece, I outran a pace car. And these dudes f***ing mad cause they can't even find a day job. I stay hard with or without Viagra. And I said the flow crush like the force of Niagara. I'm after a major label budget, but since I'm not pop top 40, they all scared to touch it.